Hi, I'm Mike Askew, one of the series editors at MathsBeat. Thanks for joining me while I talk about some of the thinking behind the design of the MathsBeat materials, some of the principles about learning and teaching that we believe are really important to bring into being in the classroom, and also how those principles play out in the design of a particular task, so you can see how MathsBeat might support you in helping all of your children come to understand mathematics and engage with it in a way that they find productive and enjoyable. Before drilling down and looking at some tasks in detail, I want to talk generally about our views about how children come to learn mathematics. And there are three things that have informed that. The first is our view that maths really has to be an active experience for children to develop deep understanding of it. Now, there's a lot of talk out there about things like hands-on learning and practical learning. And by active learning, we do mean there will be a component of children working with materials, of handling base 10 blocks, of working with bead strings and so on and so forth. But we don't just mean active in the sense of being physically active. We also mean active in the sense of being mentally active. Practical materials are only useful to the extent to which they help children think about what they're doing and reflect on the materials that they're working with. No amount of sitting a child down with a pile of base 10 blocks and just leaving them to get on with it will help them understand place value. The teacher plays a really important role in this, in directing the children as to what to attend to in the place value bricks, and so bring the mathematics into the classroom. I'll talk a little bit more about how that happens through our materials in a moment. The second thing that's informed our thinking are the three aims of the national curriculum: fluency, problem solving, and reasoning. They tend to trip off the tongue in that order, and I think there's sometimes a sense that that's the order in which you have to learn mathematics, that you become fluent in something, then you go on to solve problems using those fluencies, and then if you're lucky, you get to do some reasoning about it. We actually don't see fluency, problem solving, and reasoning as being sequential in that way. We see them as being part of an intertwined set of approaches to learning mathematics that complement each other rather than follow on from each other. It's really hard when you look at how children actually learn mathematics to separate the three. Take an example like learning your number bonds and working on something like 8 add 7. We might be working on a bead string to do that, encouraging the children to move across 8 beads, separate off the 7 that they need to add on. Now, the structure of a 5-5 bead string, where you have 5 red, 5 white, 5 red, 5 white, is such that once those 8 are moved across, children are going to be able to see, quite literally, how the 8 is made up of 5 and 3, so they're reinforcing that number bond at the same time. But they're also going to be able to reason that moving 2 across will make the 8 up to 10, and then all that's left in the 7 is 5, and 10 plus 5 is a much easier calculation to do than 8 plus 7 straight off the bat. So there's a mix there of reasoning about how to make the 8 up to 10. They're solving the problem of finding an efficient way of adding the 8 and the 7, and there's also developing the fluency of knowing that number bond. So the children are actually, in a very simple task like that, in our view, engaged in all three of those aims. And the third thing behind our thinking is that maths is something that really can be made accessible to all learners. We don't believe that there's a maths gene that makes some children better at maths than others. Yes, we do believe that children come to school with different experiences of mathematics from their home background, and that will make a difference to how confident they are starting school mathematics. But a way of thinking that I think I find quite sympathetic is the view of what primary education is to do in Japanese schools. In Japanese schools, they accept that children come to school with different levels of mathematical understanding, and it's the job of primary school to kind of level the playing field and get everybody up to the starting gate of secondary school mathematics. So we firmly believe that more children can do more mathematics if it's presented to them in an engaging and accessible way. So how do we take those three principles and put them into practice in designing some materials? At the core of MathsBeat are three things that I like to think of as a kind of tripod that supports teaching. And those three things are tasks, tools, and most importantly, talk. Teaching and learning maths is only as good as the tasks we give children to engage on. And tasks are the complement to what I was talking about in terms of mathematical activity. A good task will engage children in good mathematical activity. Many tasks that you see in school don't have a strong separation between the task and the activity that the children are subsequently going to engage in. What the children are often doing is just replicating what the teacher's shown them what to do, so it looks like they're engaging in mathematical activity, but they're really just remembering what to do rather than actually thinking about it. So we try to design tasks that are not only easy to set up, but give the children some responsibility for having to sort out what mathematics to do within the task. If you like, it means problem solving is at the heart of the MathsBeat materials. And I want to make the distinction here between learning to solve problems and learning through problem solving. So learning through problem solving means giving the children a problem to work on, which is going to engage them in mathematical activity. And then as the teacher, who again is crucial in all of this, it's her role or his role to help the child see the mathematics that was embedded in their solution to the problem and help them refine the mathematics and develop their mathematical thinking in that way. So learning through problem solving, the problems are chosen to engage children in mathematical thinking, in mathematical activity, rather than simply to teach them how to solve more problems like the one they've just been engaged with. The second thing that supports this teaching are the tools that are available to children to help them work on their mathematical activity. Those tools are going to be things like, as I was mentioning, base 10 blocks and bead strings, but there are also some thinking tools that children need to engage in, like asking themselves, have I seen anything like this before? Or what could I do to make this simpler? And the third part of this tripod that supports teaching is talk. Tasks and tools, they're not going to be very helpful if there isn't the talk to glue them together, if there isn't the talk to direct children's attention to the mathematics that they've been engaged in and to draw out the key mathematical ideas and make those explicit. So tasks, tools and talk are embedded throughout the MathsBeat materials to support not only you in your teaching, but your children in developing their mathematical understanding. Let's have a look at what that looks like in one particular unit. Let's see what this all looks like in practice by looking at one of the units from year one of MathsBeat. This is the last unit for term one, and it's an introduction to multiplication and division. In line with the national curriculum, we're not really working here yet on committing multiplication facts to memory, or even using the multiplication symbol, but about helping children get a sense of what multiplication and division means by solving problems using concrete objects and pictorial representations. The national curriculum mentions arrays, but we come to that in the later unit. The first week of this two-week unit focuses on multiplication situations, and there are five tasks that we suggest will help your children get to understand where multiplication comes from. A big idea that children need to get to grips with in multiplication is the move from using one to talk about one object to talking about one group of objects. So children who are only just getting to grips with the idea that that's one have to suddenly coordinate the idea that this is one group of three with three objects in it. So I can talk about one group, but it has three dots in it. That's a big idea, and it's at the heart of developing a sound understanding of what multiplication is about. So the launch task works with images of equal groups to start this language, this talk about one group having three pieces of fruit in it and so on and so forth. The task I want to look at is learning task one, which takes up that idea and encourages children to explore it in a little more depth. We've called this first learning task pieces of fruit, and it's intended to help children begin to get a sense of where multiplication comes from. It's an example of what I was saying earlier, which is learning through problem solving. Although it starts off with giving the children a problem to solve, The intention isn't that they're actually learning to solve multiplication problems, but that they can find a practical way to solve a problem, and we can use that to build on and develop their understanding of multiplication. The tools they're using are going to be small world animals or paper plates, and if you have them, play fruits or counters. And we're not expecting children to read and interpret a problem at this stage. So the idea is you've already set up a problem that four bears are having a picnic and they've got three pieces of fruit each. We don't want children to have to hold that information in their head, so we suggest you jot down four bears and three fruits on the board. And leave that on the board for later, which I'll come back to in a moment. The task then is for children to use the practical materials to set up a model of the situation. And their activity is quite practical at this stage, but some of them will start to see ways of thinking about this which go beyond simply setting out the model. In order to have a productive talk about what's gone on, we suggest that rather than asking for volunteers to share with the class what they've done, that as the children are working on this, you look for two or three examples and invite those children in particular to come and talk about what they've done. In that conversation, we've suggested some questions you might ask about how many pieces of fruit there are altogether, who counted them in ones, and in particular this important move, did anyone count them in a different way? Did anyone see that they might begin to count 3, 6, 9? Once that problem's been talked about in some depth, the learning is taken on by children creating for themselves some further problems and exploring what goes on there. We suggest a simple way of setting this up is to just write the digits 2, 3 and 4 on the board and have that be the number of bears, and in another circle have 1, 2, 4 and 5 and have that as the pieces of fruit. You may notice here that we've missed out 3 this time. Although 3 was in the original problem, 1, 2, 4 and 5 have been chosen quite deliberately so that the children are feeling very unconfident, might only give one piece of fruit to each bear. But also children who maybe give two pieces of fruit to several bears can start to see that a way of counting that is to count in twos, 2, 4, 6. 2 and 4 and 5 are easier to count on than 3 at this stage. And so it's not such a good idea to include 3, as it's less likely to prompt the children into counting in groups. Again, they're going to be working practically, setting up a model of their situation, and again we suggest that as they're doing that, you look out for the 2 or 3 examples that you think are going to move the conversation on. The next part of the lesson actually sets up something quite crucial, and it's based in something that you might have heard people talking about, which is variation theory. Variation theory is based on the idea that we learn as much about things by looking at non-examples or contrasting examples as we do by looking at lots and lots of the same thing. So now the invitation is to set up on the board an addition problem where there's one bear who has 4 pieces of fruit followed by 3 pieces of fruit. Notice that the numbers 4 and 3 are exactly the same as the numbers 4 and 3 that were recorded and left on the board from earlier. It's quite likely that some children will actually replicate what was done originally, because the lesson so far has been about making equal groups. But the key thing is to have this conversation about what's the same and what's different in each of these situations. That in one problem they were making equal groups, and in the other problem they were combining two groups. Every task comes with a suggestion for how you might deepen the learning for any children who appear to be getting on top of it quite quickly. In this case, we suggest asking the children if they can find some way of recording what they've done using pictures or symbols. That will reveal something about whether any of the children have seen the multiplication symbol before or whether they can use the addition symbol to represent repeated addition. Each learning task also comes with advice on assessment for learning, how you can assess children's understanding of what they're doing as the task is unfolding. We give suggestions for what to look out for children who we think are going to be showing that they're on track with the intended learning outcomes, but also based on our experience of being in school and in research findings, we identify 2 or 3 things that might be confusing some children and could usefully be picked up with and worked within the context of the task. So I hope that gives you some sense of how we've set out setting up a task and how it might play out in a classroom. I hope that's given you some sense of the thinking behind the MathsBeat materials and given you some insight into how they might support you and your children in learning and teaching mathematics. If you'd like to learn more, please go to the website where there's some materials you can look at, and also you can sign up for a free trial. Thanks for watching.